Welcome you all once again. In today's class we are going to do part 3 of this chapter, acid bases and salts. Before getting into today's session, I want to do a quick revision of what we had done in the previous classes. So acids are substances that are sour to taste, they change blue litmus red, they dissociate into hydrogen ions. Bases are substances, chemical substances that are bitter to taste, they are soapy to touch and they turn red litmus blue, they dissociate into hydroxide ions. And then we had learnt about the acids present in the food items that we consume in our everyday life. And then we had learnt about reaction of acids with metals. When acids react with metals, they form the corresponding salt and they liberate hydrogen gas. When acids react with metallic carbonates and bicarbonates, they form salt, water and they give out carbon dioxide gas. When acids react with a base, they form salt and water, and this reaction is said to be a neutralization reaction. When acids react with metallic oxides, they also form salt and water. So we can conclude metallic oxides are basic in nature. Similarly, when bases react with non-metallic oxide, they also give out salt and water, which states that these non-metallic oxides are acidic in nature. This is what we had done in our previous session. Okay. Now we are going to learn, what do all acids and bases have in common? For this, you have an activity given in your textbook. We'll be doing in the classroom setup also. The experimental setup is given here. You have to take a beaker, you have to take two nails, and you have to connect the two nails with the help of wires to a 6-volt battery, and then it should be connected to a bulb and a switch. And then you have to take the substances that are listed on the right side one by one in the beaker, and you have to see what happens when the circuit is switched on. So first, in the beaker we are taking hydrochloric acid and the circuit is closed. When you switch on, you can see the bulb emitting light. The yellow lines around the bulb shows that the bulb is giving out light, glowing brightly. So this shows that hydrochloric acid is conducting electricity, allowing electric current to pass through it, right? Then second figure shows the beaker containing glucose. The circuit is completed there. When you switch on, the bulb is not going to emit any light. That is why I have not shown the yellow lines around it. So this glucose will not allow electric current to pass through. Now next figure, you have taken alcohol. The circuit is complete, you are switching on, the bulb is not emitting light. So alcohol is also not allowing the electric current to pass through. Now you have to take dilute sulfuric acid. You have to repeat the experiment by closing the circuit, switching on, the bulb is emitting light. So we saw hydrochloric acid and sulfuric acid is helping in conducting electricity and the bulb is emitting light. So hydrochloric acid and sulfuric acid contains hydrogen ions. So acids, when dissociated in water, means when dissolved in water, dissociates into hydrogen ions, and these hydrogen ions are responsible for conduction of electricity, and they are only responsible to show the acidic nature of acids, the nature of acids being acidic, right? So we saw the hydrogen ions present in your hydrochloric acid and sulfuric acid, when it was taken in the beaker and when the circuit was closed, the bulb that was attached was emitting light. So acids conduct electricity because of the hydrogen ions present in them. Or you can say hydrogen ions present in the acids is solely responsible for the conduction of electricity. Now, see here, I've shown the same experimental setup. A base is taken, that is sodium hydroxide. Now the circuit is complete, plugged in, and then the switch is on. You can see the bulb emitting light. So this also shows that bases dissociates into hydroxyl ions, and these hydroxyl ions are responsible for the conduction of electricity, and they are only responsible to establish or to show the basic nature of bases. So what have we learnt from this? We saw the bulb emitting light only when we had taken sulfuric acid, hydrochloric acid and sodium hydroxide. With alcohol and glucose, it did not emit light. So what do acids and bases have in common? Yes, acids and bases have this tendency to conduct electric current. This is the common characteristic of acids and
basis. Understood?
So, you know that acids, when dissolved in water, dissociates into hydrogen ions, and bases, when dissolved in water, dissociate into hydroxyl ions, that is OH ions. So, do they only dissociate into hydrogen ions if it is acid in water, and bases into hydroxyl ions in water? Apart from this, something else also it shows. That is what we are going to learn in this activity. For this activity, to show that what happens to an acid or a base in water, you need to take a test tube, and in that you have to add 1 gram of sodium chloride. It's a solid nature, it's a salt. And to this you have to add sulfuric acid concentrate. So now when sulfuric acid comes in contact with sodium chloride, double displacement reaction takes place. In a double displacement reaction, negative ions swap their places. In sodium chloride, that is NaCl, your chlorine is the negative ion, Cl minus. And in sulfuric acid, that is H2SO4, your SO4 is the negative ion. So they swap their places, H2SO4 and NaCl being the reactant. The negative ions in those two compounds will swap their places, and a double displacement reaction takes place, resulting in the formation of sodium sulfate and hydrogen chloride. This HCl, what we call as hydrochloric acid, is liberated here in the gaseous form. So, to this experimental setup, we have to attach a delivery tube with the help of a cork, and the setup goes like this. See, a delivery tube is attached by using a cork. Now, bubbles will be seen at the bottom, which shows the evolution of hydrogen chloride gas. The gas that is evolved is collected with the help of a bent tube, because of which we are using a delivery tube here. Now, to test the acidic nature of the gas that is getting evolved, we will use a blue litmus paper. What is the characteristic of a blue litmus paper? It will turn red in color when it comes in contact with acids, right? So here we know the HCl gas that is coming out is acidic in nature. So in that case, it has to turn this blue litmus paper, which is dry, into red color. But the litmus paper will not undergo any color change because it is a dry litmus paper. You all know that acidic substances or acids will turn blue litmus red. Here, the litmus paper being dry, the gas that is HCl, which is acidic in nature, is not turning the blue litmus red. So what we have to do is, you have to moist the blue litmus paper and bring it to the end of the delivery tube, and you can see the moist blue litmus paper turning red. So acidic or acids will show their acidic behavior only in the presence of water. When the litmus paper, that is blue litmus paper, was dry, the acidic character, we know that HCl is acid by nature, but it is not exhibiting its acidic property because water was not present. They will show their acidic property only in the presence of water. That is why when the blue litmus paper was made moist and brought to the end of the delivery tube, it turned into red. So the turning of blue litmus, that is moist blue litmus paper, to red indicates that acids will show their acidic properties only in the presence of water. Now, if the atmosphere is moist, humid. Now, in the case of delivery tube, you will be using a guard tube. This guard tube contains calcium chloride. The tendency of the calcium chloride is to absorb the moisture. So it will absorb the moisture present in the tube, and the gas that is coming out will be totally dry. So understood the purpose of using a guard tube? A guard tube is used whenever you want to collect a dry gas. It has calcium chloride. The calcium chloride will absorb the moisture and it will allow the gas to come out in a dry form. Clear to you? Now, so this is the activity, whatever I explained now is this activity which is shown in your textbook. This will be performing in the school lab also. Clear to you? Now, so acids will show their acidic behavior only in the presence of water. I have given the reaction form here. That is sodium chloride, NaCl reacts with H2SO4 to give you Na2SO4 and HCl. Here Na2SO4 will be in aqueous form. Your HCl is in the gaseous form. Your H2SO4 is again aqueous in nature. Sodium chloride is solid by nature. Now, let us study the behavior of acids in water. What happens to acid when it is dissolved in water? When hydrochloric acid is dissolved in water, it dissociates into hydrogen ion and chlorine ions. One thing you should remember, this hydrogen ions are highly unstable. They are highly unstable. They cannot exist alone. So, they combine with water and forms hydronium ion, H3O+. So, when HCl is dissolved in water, it takes a new form and the product formed is totally new, that is hydronium ion and chlorine. Right? H3O. So, acids in water, the hydrogen ions dissociates and the hydrogen ion means the hydrogen ion present in the acid dissociates. I mean, in hydrochloric acid, the hydrogen, this acid dissociates into hydrogen ions and chlorine ions. Hydrogen ions are highly unstable. They cannot exist alone. They combine with hydrogen present in the water. So they turn, when acids are dissolved in water, they turn into hydronium ion. Any acid, when you dissolve in water, it will turn into hydronium ion. So a totally new product is formed. So HCl, when it is dissolved in water, changes into hydronium ion and chlorine ion. Clear to you? Now, let's study the behavior of bases in water. Bases, when they are dissolved in water, will not form any new product. I mean, in acids, when they are dissolved in water, they change into hydronium ion. I said hydrogen ions in acids cannot exist alone. So they combine with water to give you hydronium ion, but bases just dissociates into the respective elements present in the particular compound. For example, your sodium hydroxide is NaOH, gets split into sodium ion and hydroxyl ions. Potassium hydroxide, potassium and hydroxyl ions. Magnesium hydroxide, magnesium and hydroxyl ions. Magnesium has the valency 2, hydroxyl has the valency 1. So they swap their places and the valency get exchanged. Clear to you? So bases generate hydroxide ions in water. Bases that are soluble in water are called as alkalis. Clear to you? Understood? Okay. So now let's learn about this process called dilution. I've already told you that you cannot add water to acids for diluting. It should be the other way around. Acid should always be added to water little by little. So this is the warning sign which is given in the extreme left within that red color triangle. A warning sign which is normally displayed on the containers that are containing concentrated acids or bases. So, the process of dissolving an acid or a base in water is highly exothermic. They evolve heat. So, you should be highly cautious when you are diluting acids like your nitric acid or sulfuric acid. You should add acid little by little to water by constantly stirring. If you do it the other way around, that means if you add water to acids, it may splash out and it may cause severe injuries, burns also. So, you have to always add acid to water little by little by constantly stirring. So this mixing an acid or base with water results in the concentration of hydronium ions and hydroxyl ions per unit volume. Such a process is what is called as dilution. Clear to you? So with this we are coming to an end of this session. In the next session I'll meet with other topic. So we have learnt now acids or bases in water conduct electricity because they produce hydrogen or hydroxide ions respectively. Acids will show their acidic behavior only in the presence of water, and you also have learnt about the process of dilution. Okay, so I've attached in worksheet, try to solve it. So meet you soon. Till then, you keep learning, continue learning, stay happy. Thank you all.